And it's like I'm facing the heat right now. Are the air conditioners on? Is it warm inside here? Or is it just me? I don't know. Anyways, let's turn up the heat as far as the involvement of this audience is concerned. We have in the house the keynote speaker, Dr. Arvind Lal, who I first met through my show in Radio City. This was in 2005, you reminded me, I remember that. And since then, you've been conferred with the Padma Shri and honorary also rank as far as brigadier is concerned by the armed medical forces. You built a company literally taking the Hippocrates oath, wherein doctors are ruled by certain regulations in terms of not advertising specifically, considering that we're talking about the out-of-home awards tonight, but you managed to spread awareness as far as lifestyle diseases are concerned, ones which, if not checked in time, can be life-threatening. And I think you've done that fairly well, considering the fact that Dr. Lal Pathlabs has literally become synonymous to diagnostic procedures in the country. You have, I think, 1,500 odd centers here all throughout India. It's one of the largest also in Asia, and I think specifically in tier 2 and tier 3 cities. You see these boards of Dr. Lal Pathlabs literally, you know, all across while you're driving down from Delhi to wherever you're going. And it's a great privilege and honor for you to be here. We would like to hear the story of how your father in 1949 actually started this and what your challenges were and what your message to the out-of-home media industry is. With a loud round of applause, please.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's my proud privilege to be here today. And I would especially like to thank Mr. Anurag Batra, Ms. Subarna Chadda, who grilled me first time like nothing else in 2005 in a radio show. And Ms. Sonia Venkirada for inviting me here today. It gives me great pleasure to be here today to give this keynote address on creating India's most trusted and valued pathology lab network. That is my story. Talking about my profession, pathology, it is by definition the study of disease of the human body. Since we are living in a world where medicine has completely become evidence-based, it is no surprise that all doctors, be it a neurologist, a neurosurgeon, an ophthalmologist, an ENT surgeon, a gastroenterologist, a cardiologist, a nephrologist, a gynecologist, a urologist, or a skin specialist all have to rely on the pathologist's report. As an example, a patient coming to a physician for complaints of fever of a few days duration could be suffering from any of the following: malaria, influenza, or viral fevers like dengue fever, chikungunya, swine flu, hepatitis, typhoid fever, autoimmune disease like SLE, or leukemia, or urinary tract infection, or what is the most common infectious disease in our country, tuberculosis. It is for the pathologist to take appropriate samples from the patient and test them and establish the diagnosis so that the physician can give the correct report and the patient finally becomes free from infection or whatever he was suffering from. A complete different scenario could be that of a lady who has been married for over 2 years and goes to her obstetrician or gynecologist and complains of not getting pregnant, what we call in our jargon as infertility. The obstetrician or gynecologist tests like special x-rays, CT scans, ultrasounds, various blood tests. And in the blood tests, she also orders a few hormones, and a hormone by the name of prolactin is found to be very high. A diagnosis of a pituitary tumor in the brain is established, known as prolactinoma, and is confirmed by a CT scan also. The lady is started on a drug known as bromocriptine, And a few months later, the lady delivers a healthy baby. Therefore, it is not at all surprising for you to understand now that more than 70% of all medical decisions are taken on the basis of lab tests. Our name is synonymous with pathology testing in India, and we run our healthcare business with a lot of passion, vision, and discipline. We bring to the table very strong values for the past 67 years, giving quality pathology services to millions of our countrymen every year in most parts of the country, and we would now like to extend that to the rest of the people in all parts of the country, especially living in Tier 3 and Tier 4 towns. We believe in total quality management, known as EQM, which means that we must get the test right the first time, and we must get it right every time. We run our business with a lot of conscience and with strong moral ethics. We are by training compassionate and give the much needed human touch and the same best quality to our patient, be it the president of India or a rickshaw puller on the streets. We are driven by a feeling of care, empathy for our patients, and thus we were able to touch the lives of nearly 10 million patients and clients last year. We consider it our moral duty to improve the health of our people by taking the lead to make high quality and innovative diagnostics accessible to our people at affordable prices. Now about my story. For me personally, the battle to become a doctor soon began after the realization at the age of 15, when I was the best cadet NCC Navy in Model School, Barakamba Road, New Delhi, that I could not join the National Defense Academy to become a fighter pilot in the Navy. I did not have biology as a subject in school, as I had the mistaken belief that by studying the alternative subject of geometrical drawing, I would be able to better chart the course of a ship, in this case, an aircraft carrier. I also had a cranky belief, you are aware that boys on entering teens can be very, very opinionated, that boys who studied biology were not men, and boys who studied arts were in fact in between men and women. That's what I used to think. So my own transformation from a man to a boy started in light earnest, and I truly hated studying biology. I remember asking my biology teacher in an exam that he should tell me as a special case the beginning of the page number and the ending of the page number that had the answer to a particular question, because I had memorized almost the entire book by A.C. Datta. I had obviously no clue to the nature of the question, leave aside the answer. For this indiscretion, he yelled at me and twisted my ears, and my indifference to anything medical probably started when I was a little boy. I used to be foxed as to why my father would kill the rabbits with whom I loved playing with in our house on Hanuman Road. That also had my father's pathology laboratory. This, I learned later, was carried out to sacrifice the bunny rabbit for starting its ovaries after injecting it with the lady's urine for the then only available pregnancy test. So we come a long way. Now a lady in the privacy of her own house, in her own bathroom, can test herself for a pregnancy. I took over the lab in the year 1977, after the untimely death of my father. At that particular point of time, I was a lecturer in pathology in the Armed Forces Medical College, Pune, where I was also the warden of the boys' hospital. By that time, when I joined my father's pathology practice, I started to pride myself in believing that I knew everything that was needed to know in pathology. You can imagine to my utter disbelief, when I'm taking over the reins of the lab, I discovered the shortcuts and cutting the corners in lab testing that were taking place. So it was no surprise that my first couple of years in private practice were completely spent in making correct testing protocols and preparing homebrew reagents for biochemistry and other tests. This involved ordering raw material from abroad that was not easy in India, because India prided itself restricting all imports and saving of valuable foreign exchange. Using more time, first time in a private lab, a single pad, metal electronic balance, a sensitive pH meter, installing very sensitive spectrophotometers, single well gamma scintillation counters, permitting dangerous radioactive material by mouth, and many such mundane laboratory chores, and thus started my indoctrination in the beautiful world of private pathology practice. Now, it is slightly more technical, but these are the game changers in my life. To my mind, 1981 was a game changer with the introduction of thyroid tests in a private laboratory for the first time in India, and thus the introduction of the first and also the first automated blood chemistry auto-analyzer in northern India were the real game changers in healthcare industry. Now you don't even bat an eyelid before going for a thyroid test, but believe you me, it was not easy the first time. In 1982, the creation of hubs and spokes and introduction of franchising for the first time in healthcare in the world, that is of collection centers, and the current number, as Swarna said, is about 1,500 plus. In 1986, I introduced the first computerized, dedicated lab information management system known as LIMS for the first time in India. The lab, when I joined, was testing about 30 patients a day, and by 1986, the workload had gone up to 60 patients a day, and today we test up to 50,000 patients in a single day. And last year, as I mentioned earlier, we tested nearly 10 million patients. This required the services at that time, in 1986, two typists who would continue to bang on their typewriters from 12 noon onwards. The day one of the typists was absent, all hell would break loose. Thus, the first software program was written for a lab in India. Thus, we were able to fully computerize our lab operations. We did not have to type the reference ranges or the normal values on the right-hand side, and the abnormal ones would automatically get highlighted. This was the second game changer in the lab line in India. In 1989, we were the first private lab in India to start HIV or AIDS testing. Secondly, the introduction of the second generation auto-analyzer, known as BM-Hitachi 717, was the next game changer in the industry, and became the first lab in India, Middle East, and Southeast Asia to install such a chemistry auto-analyzer. This instrument revolutionized lab testing in India. The instrument had a speed of 600 samples in 1 hour. This was also the first such instrument supplied between West Europe and Japan, including Africa. With this, we also introduced a unique blood collection system by vacuum tubes, known as vacuumainers, for the first time in India. Till then, we were using syringe and needle, which you must have seen in your days. Then the next game changer was 1994. Corning Clinical Laboratories, now known as Quest Laboratories, invited me to the USA to visit their biggest Teterboro lab in New Jersey and visit to their Corning headquarters, New York State. We became partners, and for the first time, we could send to America sophisticated blood tests that were not available in India. And that too by charging the Indian patient in rupees, converting them in US dollars, thanks to the new liberalization of the Indian economy by Dr. Manmohan Singh and sending them to the USA. In 1998, the third largest laboratory chain in Australia, known as Rivers Pathology, started its operations in India. I geared up to take competition head on by creating more labs and collection centers. This is a story similar to that of McDonald's entering Philippines and being beaten there by the local fast food chain known as Jollibee. You can see it was another David and Goliath story. Then in 1999, we became the first Indian lab to install, at that point of time, world's most prestigious Triple G lab software, or LIMS. It gave us in India for the first time a true bi-directional interface wherein the diagnostic machine would directly talk to the computer, the central computer. It also gave us the connectivity between other labs and hospital labs. Though the software was in Unix and the database was Unify 2000, its sturdiness was truly amazing. Later in the year 2012, we had another upgrade of the lab information management system, and we changed it to a new thing known as StarLens. In 2003, we had to reject an offer of 50% JV with the largest labs in the world known as Quest Diagnostics of their entering India. Again, we beat them to the game, and in fact, many people don't even know that Quest Diagnostics, which is the world's largest lab chain, is present in India. In 2005, Westbridge Capital Partners acquired 26% of stake in our company and invested 28 crores in our business. Also in 2005, corporatizing of the business by induction of a COO, Om Manchanda, a former IIM Ahmedabad graduate and ex-Hindustan Lever Monsanto and Rand Vaccine. In 2010, opening of Asia's biggest laboratory, having a covered area of 85,000 square feet at Rohini in New Delhi. And finally, from 2012 till presently, perfecting the hub and spoke model by operating 172 labs all over India, more than 1,550 collection centers, and picking up samples from another 7,000 pickup points, which include major hospitals like Medanta, Max, and many more all over India, and testing 50,000 patients in a day. Now, I would like to share some experience with you that what are the qualities which I feel are important into becoming a successful entrepreneur. The first thing is that as Indians, we always fear failure. So in my opinion, by and large, many Indians are afraid to fail, and therefore one of the best policies we as Indians have imbibed is that if you don't work at all, you cannot fail. I'm talking about the government sector. This is in stark contrast to the more successful people in Western countries that keep on trying and ultimately success comes. Remember that in every failure, there is a very strong learning that will propel you to success in your next venture. My mantra in life has been to research, plan, and then execute. And this mantra will normally not let you down, but there can be times when you may feel that the world has come crushing on you. I think every entrepreneur in his life has had this feeling. Thomas Alva Edison, the noted inventor of God knows how many things in the world, was also the inventor of the electric bulb. But I bet you don't know that before he hit the bulb glowing for the first time, he had failed 10,000 times. Next, I would like to say that we Indians are very intelligent individually, but I keep telling everyone that collectively we could not have gathered a bigger bunch of fools. For this, I will tell you a story of Shatrughan Sinha, the noted film actor and politician, who said in a very old edition of film magazine Filmfare, when asked by a reader in the question answers column, he was asked, name any three people who we like best. To this, Shotgun answered, I, me, and myself, as if we did not like any fourth person. This about sums up the entire story of us Indians, who like ourselves so much that we become incompatible to work as a team. I would like to emphasize that teamwork is what is going to get you and our country ahead in these trying times when the world economy keeps going into a recession. If you inculcate the fundamental spirit of teamwork, only then will our country or your company go to greener heights. When you have become the CEO or the member of one such company, and you have automatically made your position next to great visionaries like Jack Welch, Narayan Murthy, and Arjun Premji, so everything is possible in India. Now I'm going to talk about being an athlete, but a corporate athlete. Since I am a medical doctor and my company sees nearly 50,000 patients in a day, I see a fair number of patients with what we call non-communicable diseases or NCDs. India is now recognized as being the diabetic capital of the world, with approximately 6.5 crore Indians suffering from diabetes, 18 crore Indians suffering from high blood pressure, and about 3 crore suffering from heart disease, another 28 lakhs suffering from cancer, crores suffering from obesity, lakhs suffering from kidney and liver disease. Even the government of India has woken up, and this time in the new budget, they have said that they will be introducing a program in which 2 lakh more kidney failure patients will be given dialysis. By now, you must have all heard of people in their 20s and 30s dying of heart disease, diabetes or cancer. Please remember that a healthy mind is a healthy body, and conversely, a healthy body is a healthy mind. All the diseases that are included in the term NCDs or non-communicable diseases have a genetic element, which broadly means that your parents have a large hand in passing you on these genes to make you prone to these diseases. My dear ladies and gentlemen, please remember that you can change everything in the world, but you cannot change your parents. In other words, you can do sweet nothing about the diabetes, high blood pressure, coronary artery disease, or cancer genes that your parents have passed on to you. But the other great element of factors giving rise to these full-fledged diseases are purely due to yourselves because of your altered lifestyle. Thus, these diseases are also known as lifestyle diseases, whose advent is purely in your hands. Therefore, I implore all of you not to fall prey to these so-called lifestyle diseases. For this, you should have to exercise for a minimum half an hour to 45 minutes every day, at least 5 days in a week. Once you have joined business or you are already in business, you should take up either plain simple walking, jogging, or swimming, or any other activity which burns up calories. You would be pleasantly surprised to know that all long distance runners and other athletes secrete large numbers or quantities of hormones in the brain known as beta endorphin. This is a morphine-like alkaloid and gives you a natural high. Morphine gives you a high. This is secreted in your own brain, known as beta endorphin, and it gives you a high. It is for this reason that you find sportsmen to be jovial persons who do not brood and are liked by everybody. Just imagine if instead of me, Navjot Singh Sidhu was standing here. He's a very jovial man. So now you can see that not only regular exercise will keep you all healthy and from the above killer diseases, but also keep you mentally alert and capable of generating great ideas and taking your companies to even greater heights. So the next question that I want to answer for you is that how did we transform from a family business to a corporate entity? And now, by the way, I want to mention, we went public about 2.5 months back, and our public issue has been rated as one of the best IPOs in the last 5 years. We started off at 550 rupees a share, and within 24 hours, jumped 50%, now trading even today at about 920-930 rupees.
So, Dr. apologies for me to interject at this point in time, but what this audience would definitely want to know is, despite the fact that you have grown from where you've grown, and we've understood exactly what you have done, what were the challenges for you to have actually come here in terms of advertising, considering that doctors as professionals are not supposed to use the advertising medium, and how you leverage the out-of-home industry specifically?
Yeah. So, we as doctors are not supposed to advertise. We can pass on a good message, like I told you about non-communicable diseases, etc. But we have to do bringing in awareness and education. So what we have to do is to make patient literature, and this helps us in typing the disease-based input with rich and simple content, and the test available with us with the address, phone number. The patient must know where he has to go. Secondly, this patient information literature is very focused and it's high utilization, and it's very category specific input. For example, cardiac disease is one, cancer than the other, or high blood pressure, diabetes. Customers find an easy correlation of the symptoms, and further call to action help them in getting their test done. And we also have to give these information literatures do's and don'ts instructions to help the customer change their lifestyle, like I just mentioned. Then we have a second part of advertising, known as preventive package promotion through paper insertions. And these are traditional but cost-effective way of promotion. Almost half the cost in comparison of giving a full-fledged paper advertisement. And the next point here is that we use this to promote, again, lifestyle diseases and how to cut them down, and preventive packages promotion. Also, this acts as a reminder for customer, relevant customers, get a push for their testing. This also helps the peer pressure from building up in the family to go for regular testing, as it is, it has a high shelf life. Most of us Indians, we don't want to go for tests because this is whatever will happen, should happen, or will happen. But that's not the right way. Outdoor media, as Swarna told you, especially in UP and Bihar, you can put up big boards. I've seen boards on the way to Ranikhet, Nainital, etc. Of doctors, it's in Hindi, the doctor so-and-so is a neurosurgeon, etc. And those metro boards, bus standing, no parking exercise, etc. And this helps in building brand and the product. Majority get used for product promotion. Also, it's a mass media promotion where multiple eyeballs help the communication get noticed. And finally, it helps to improve the brand recall and the top of the mind recall. Majorly, we have used it for a new location launch. Thank you very much.